Holy God, we gather here on this afternoon within the fellowship of these walls and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit that draws us together, not only at this time of the year, but especially this time of the year as we are celebrating that season of Advent, as we are ready in our homes and our hearts for the coming of the Christ child once again into our lives. And to this end, may all of our activities this afternoon further that, that we might walk closer with you, and may the program this afternoon and the fellowship of these tables lead us into that space where we are ready, our hearts are prepared to receive you once again. For we pray these things in the name of the one we anticipate, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And just right now, I'm talking as if I was Elsie Burbank, and I can't possibly be her, and I don't want to be, but I did tell her I would try to walk in her steps today. So this event was started. I came here in 1997, and in 2002, she asked me to play my cello at a program she was putting together for the Women's Fellowship. There was a Women's Fellowship here at this church in 2003. And so I was very touched to be asked, and I was very nervous, and I couldn't stand playing my cello and solos. I still don't like it. But Elsie had me, and you know what? I played for her for the many times until 2015 was the last time we had this tea. So this year, when she was feeling better and John was doing well, she said, you know, it would make me really happy if we could do the fellowship tea again. And Louise and I and Kay, who are Caring Connection coordinator, said, this would be perfect because we have people who can't come to church on Sunday mornings sometimes, but they still love people and they love to see them. So we've done our very best to get people who can't come to church every Sunday morning to be here together, to not only have fun, we're gonna start by having fun and eating and talking, and I hated to stop you talking, I'm sorry, but it had to come. And then we're gonna continue with our story of the women at Jesus' birth. So ladies, let's talk, have fun sharing, and let's have a lot of fun today and getting things done. And know we love you all. And you and Elsie, you're going to get to see this, and we love you, all of us. Have a great day, all of you, and have a wonderful time.
Thank you.
Elsie wanted this particular poem read today. And so I've been thinking about it for a week or so. And I thought, why would we have this poem at a church service, which I have been to so many in my lifetime. So I went back to think about the beginning when the three Magi came to the cradle and brought gifts to the Christ child who has brought so much into our lives. And then I thought later, we heard about Saint Nicholas, who was a French, well, I think he was Italian priest, many, many centuries ago, who brought gifts to unfortunate families and children all over the place where he was. And so then, 60 or 70 years ago, when I was teaching French, we had a little French club at Christmas time. And so what we did was I found some carols in French, and so we read the history of Saint Nicholas, and of course he was pronounced Saint Nicholas. Saint Nicholas. And so that made me think, well, that must be where Santa Claus came from. I had never heard any other story. But anyway, so this is Santa Claus. This is the Magi. This is the story of helping little children understand the gifts we receive at Christmas time, even though they are from the heart, mostly. So I'm reading this, Elsie, this is for you. was the night before Christmas when all through the house, not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. The stockings were hung by the chimney with care in hopes that San Nicolas soon would be there. The children were nestled all snug in their beds while visions of sugar plum danced in their heads. And Mama in her kerchief and I in my cap had settled our brain for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn, there arose such a clatter, I sprang from my bed to see what was the matter. Away to the windows I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters and threw up the sash. The moon on the breast of the new falling snow gave a luster of midday to objects below, when what to my wondering eyes should appear but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer. With a little old driver so lively and quick, I knew in a moment it must be St. Nick. More rapid than eagles his coursers they came, and he whistled and shouted and called out their name. Now Dasher, now Dancer, now Prancer, now Vixen, oh Comet, on Comet, Donner and Blitzen. To the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all. As leaves that before the wild hurricane fly, when they meet with an obstacle, mount to the sky. So up to the housetop the coursers they flew, with a sleigh full of toys and St. Nicholas too. And then in a twinkling I heard on the roof the prancing and pawing of each little hoof. As I drew in my head and was turning round, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound. He was dressed all in fur from his head to his foot, and his clothes were all tarnished with ashes and soot. A bundle of toys he had on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes, how they twinkled, his dimples, how merry. His cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry. His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and the beard on his chin was as white as the snow. The stump of a pipe he held tight in his teeth, and the smoke, it encircled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly. He was chubby and plump, a right jolly old elf, and I laughed when I saw him in spite of myself. A wink of his eye and a twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread. He spoke not a word, but went straight to his work and filled all the stockings, then turned with a jerk. And laying his finger aside of his nose and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to his sleigh, to his team gave a whistle, and away they all flew like the down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim ere he drove out of sight, "Happy Christmas to all, and to all a good night." Thank you.
I am Elizabeth, the wife of Zacharias and the mother of John. Called the Baptist, the cousin of the girl Mary. The miracle of my conception, the strange and wonderful things that occurred in the life of my husband, the life and death of my son, are most wondrous and filled with the power of the Lord. Were there time, I would tell you of it all from the beginning of those lonely and despairing years when Zacharias and I became convinced that I was the most useless of all vessels. A barren woman, to the tragic death of my fine son at the whim of court harlot. I would tell you of the glory and wonder of that day in the house of the Lord, the temple of the Most High, when a heavenly radiance shone round, and for the first time in many generations, a heavenly messenger appeared. I would try to describe to you the look in the eyes of my aged husband as he suffered the silence of discipline and his exultation when he was finally able to cry that I, an old woman, was to conceive and bear the man-child that would make straight the way for the coming of the Lord. I would tell you of that child, of his strength and goodness, of his power and humility, of his complete submission to the will of the Almighty God. But there is no time, and so I will share with you only one small moment, most precious to me, that lifted my spirit and made my heart overflow with gratitude and goodness of God. Within my body, I carried a child. You women who have experienced the wonder and awe of those first trembling movements of beginning life will know what I knew when, as my cousin Mary came to my door. I felt my babe leap within me as the Holy Ghost bore solemn witness that the chosen mother of the Lord stood before me. I knew that thrill incident to the quickening spirit of my own blessed conception, and I returned her greeting with gratitude and reverence. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb. She responded, that flawless vessel of the Lord, with one of the most beautiful and glorious hymns of praise known to humankind. My soul does magnify the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior. For he has regarded the low estate of the handmaiden. For behold, from here forward, all generations shall call me blessed. For he that is mighty has done to me great things, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. He has showed strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent empty away. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of this mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and his seed forever. Indeed, he had done all those glorious things, but even more, he had given to mankind his own son, and for one precious instant in eternity, he had granted to an ordinary old woman the privilege of a personal witness that this was indeed the Christ. Savior of the world, I bear to each of you this day that same witness.
I am the mother of Joseph, the carpenter. Joseph was my son. He's a quiet man, strong and steady, with wonderful eyes, kind, gentle, and warm. When he enters our home in the evenings with clean scent of new wood about him and the tiny, fragile shavings still clinging to the coarseness of his robe, the room filled with his presence. It becomes a place of peace and contentment. And while he is not given to laughter, the serious, soft-spoken son of mine has nevertheless a slow, sweet smile about him. It transforms his face and warms the hearts of all those around him. He is a good man, my Joseph, with a deep and abiding faith in God and the strength that keeps his laws. And so it was, when he thought the law had been broken, his eyes spoke of the pain his lips could not, and the shadows filled his home where had only been love and light before. You see, Joseph had finished his carpenter apprenticeship and was about to take a wife. He had chosen for his own the girl Mary, fine and gentle, as pure and as fair as the morning light. And the love they bore, these two, one for the other, made our whole world a better place to be. And so, both families agreeing, the betrothal ceremony took place. It was as binding as marriage, indeed. If the bridegroom should happen to die, the law considers the betrothal girl a widow. If she is unfaithful, she is labeled an adulteress. And once betrothed, the only way contract can be broken is through divorce. Now, I tell you this that you may know the custom here in Galilee, and that you might better begin to understand what was in our hearts in the days that followed. We were nearly ready, Joseph and I and Mary and her family. The marriage was about to take place. A year after the betrothal, and our time had been spent in carefully, lovingly furnishing a small home that was to be their own, and in preparing for the solemn reception in that home. I was so proud, proud of my strong son, and proud of the lovely woman with whom he had chosen to share his life. And then, suddenly and amazingly, Mary was with child. It was not to be believed, not Mary, and yet it was so. I had only to look into the face of my Joseph to know that the moral agony I saw had nothing to do with a rumor or doubt. To divorce or send away the woman he loved, according to the Jewish laws, these were the only two alternatives. She could be sent away to have her child and not return to Nazareth, hurt and humiliated. Love of the law and love of one's wife to be, Joseph was torn with pain and I suffered with him. And then, like a miracle, the shadows were gone. We say little of what happened that night, for it was a private thing that happened, not to be subject to doubts and jeers of a mocking world. What was said in that moment when a messenger of the Lord spoke to my son is for him alone to know. But the purpose was plain. This woman, this most dear woman, was infinitely worthy to become even dearer. Mary of Nazareth, most blessed among women, was to become the mother of the Messiah. With strength and dignity, filled with faith and the desire to give his Mary as much protection and devotion as possible, Joseph married her immediately, and my heart swelled with pride. You see, of all the souls in heaven, the Lord God had his choice of the man to be the earthly father of his only begotten son. With great care and deliberation, would he have chosen a man to do the thousand, no millions of gentle, thoughtful things a father does for a beloved son? It was Joseph who would cradle the babe in his strong, clean, work-roughened hands. Joseph who would walk with him in and through the hills and the streets and into the synagogue for evening prayers and to smile at him across the table. If I, like the Lord, knowingly, I could not be the earthly companion of my beloved, my only begotten son, were I to choose such a companion to take my place, I would choose the very best. The very best. I would choose from among the kind of men I had known and respected before the foundations of this world were laid, men like Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, who was sold to Egypt, Noah, Moses, Enoch, and Elijah. And yet my son, Joseph, the carpenter, was chosen to be the earthly father of Jesus, the Christ, Savior of the world. Joseph, my son.
Thank you. I am Mother of Mary. And yes, you are right. There is not a great deal said of me, but that is as it should be. My place in the warp and weave of the patterns of those days is inconspicuous, unheralded, yet it is not without its moments of attending glory. For you see, it is my grandson that is called Redeemer, Savior, Jesus the Christ. It was my daughter, young, sweet, pure, and ever obedient, to whom Gabriel appeared. My daughter, to whom he said, Mary, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. In common with other daughters of Israel, specifically those of the tribe of Judah and of known descendant from David, my Mary had contemplated with holy joy and ecstasy the coming of the Messiah through our royal line. She knew that some Jewish maiden was yet to become the mother of the Christ. But was it possible that the angel's words to her had reference to the supreme expectation and hope of the nation? She had little time to turn these things in her mind, for the angel continued, Fear not, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you shall conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God shall give to him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Even yet she comprehended but in part the importance of this momentous visitation, not in the spirit of doubt such as had prompted Zacharias to ask for a sign, but through an earnest desire for information she asked, How shall this be? Since I am a virgin. This answer to her natural and simple inquiry was the announcement of a miracle through the operation of a higher law, such as the human mind ordinarily fails to comprehend or regard possible. Mary was informed she would conceive and in time bring forth a son, of whom no mortal man would be the father. And the angel answered and said to her, The Holy Spirit shall come upon you, and the power of the highest shall overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be the Son of God. Then the angel told her of the blessed condition of her cousin Elizabeth, who had been barren, and by way of sufficient and final explanation added, For with God nothing shall be impossible. With gentle and humble acceptance, the pure young virgin replied, Behold, the handmaiden of the Lord, be it unto me according to your word. His message delivered, Gabriel departed, leaving the chosen virgin of Nazareth to ponder over her wondrous experience. My daughter's promised son was to be the only begotten of the Father in the flesh. The child Jesus was to inherit the physical, mental, and spiritual traits, tendencies, and powers that characterized his parents, one immortal and glorified God, the other human woman, my daughter Mary. This child whom I had conceived and reared, for whom I had wiped tears and mended broken dolls, who had worked at my side, was to be the mother of God. I knew her better than any other person on the face of the earth, and I say to you, she was fit for her calling, pure, stainless, and infinitely good. She had the strength and the courage to humbly accept not only the birth, but also the crucifixion and death of her perfect son, Jesus of Nazareth. I watched him grow, both in body and spirit, and long before I was called to leave this earth, indeed, even from the very beginning, when an angel of the Lord visited our simple Galilean cottage with the greatest news ever given, I knew that the child Jesus was indeed the Christ. He was my grandson. He is my Lord. I know it. I glory in it. I testify of it. And so be it forever.
Thank you. husband is a shepherd, and at times in the spring of the year when the nights are cool and the stars hang so low in the heavens, I want to reach up and pull one to me with the crooked end of my husband's staff. We go into the fields, and there, together, we watch the flocks. There are those who say we are poor, that of the many who come and go, wander and stay in this beloved and ancient land, we are the lowliest and the most humble. Humble? Perhaps. Indeed, it is what we desire. But poor? Oh, my friend, if only I could give you the eyes to see and the heart to feel the vastness and incredible beauty of the ageless Judean hills. The deep peace and contentment we found in this land of unspoiled solitude, the quiet, almost unspeakable joy, the joy we feel in companionship we share, one with another, and with God. Hardly poor, in fact, infinitely richer than the madman Herod, who sits decaying with disease and corruption in his marble palace beyond the hills. They say of Herod that within his great palace are vast treasures of gold and precious gems. And yet I, the wife of a lowly shepherd, would not part with one instant, be it so small, of the miracle that unfolded before us in the fields not so very long ago. No, not for 100 times or 100 times again the wealth of the man who dares to call himself our king. They tell of that night of all nights, in a great book, the one you call the Bible. It tells in words lovely and true of that night when worlds and eternity alike stood still and witnessed the birth of Jesus the Christ. And I was there. It was I who stood with my heart, my soul, soaring, shivering, and singing while the glory of the Lord shone about. The glory of the Lord. There are no words to describe it. It was like the first dawning on all creation, and every dawn thereafter, glowing and melting into one, shimmering, shining, throbbing, awesome, and frightening. And we were afraid. But then came the voice, clear and piercing and sweet and beautiful beyond description. Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward all. Like an infinite and eternal exultation of larks that sang until my heart most surely would shatter, and the tears ran down my cheeks and dropped unnoticed upon my clasped and trembling hands. To you, who have read my story and considered it a tale for fools and children, I can say only this, that from this eternity to the next, never ending to never ending, I saw what I saw, and I tell you the truth, as pure and clean and bright as the noonday sun, worlds without end, it cannot and will not change. For the humble, it is easy to believe, as we believed what we heard that night. And because we believed, we went and did see the child lying in a manger. We saw that night a sight multitudes of people, past, present, future, kings and commoners, princes and potentates, and they would give their lives to see the infant Son of the Lord God. Poor, ours was a divine gift, a sacred treasure, to be kept deep within the heart, wandered at, pondered upon, cherished, and then to be told in great reverence in the quiet of the night to children, and they to theirs, from generation to generation, forever.
I am the wife of the keeper of an inn. For generations, my husband's family have been keepers of an inn here in Bethlehem. And now, together, we do the same. Ours is a small inn, humble and unpretentious, nevertheless as clean as we can make it. We take pride in our simple but carefully prepared meals, our scrubbed floors, and well-aired bedding. Sometimes there are flowers growing from our window pots, and we take pleasure in our small business. It is not a large town, this Bethlehem of Judea, and most of those calling it home are simple farmers and shepherds. And yet, still and all, it is a beloved and revered village, endeared to Jewish hearts as the birthplace of David and that of the prospective Messiah. Each morning for many years, I have swept clean the packed earth in front of our door and have looked into the faces of those passing through our small village. I have seen many things there: anger, despair, pride, acceptance, peace, selfishness, exhaustion. The faces I forgot, but the things I saw there stay with me, reminding me of how fortunate I am to be at peace, content with my life and those things the Lord has seen fit to bestow upon me. And then came the time of the tax rolls, the proclamation of Caesar Augustus that here shall be a taxing and registration of the house of David. It was the second of three such registrations to be held at intervals of about 20 years. Sleepy Bethlehem was not itself. Its quiet streets were choked with dust and filled with the voice of tired, hurrying people. The outer inn was filled to the rafters, and to escape for a moment the noise, the heat, and the hurry, I fled to my dooryard. As was my custom, I stood there for a moment, gazing down the street, studying the faces. There was a donkey, and leading it, a strong young man, obviously fatigued, and yet somehow different. There was a pride in the face and dignity. He was a poor man, and yet I have seen, passing my door, great men of the world with much less a look of nobility. This was a man of the house of David, a house of kings, and here was one of the same royal lineage, yet he was more. And then I saw the face of the young woman, exhausted and great with child, riding on the back of the donkey. If the man leading the animal had about him the air of royalty, This surely was a queen. Her face was drawn with fatigue, and her simple robes powdered with a fine light dust that lies thick along the rose of Judea. And yet no trace of discontent, no shadow of complaint, no faint inclination to murmur could I see. Slowly they came closer and stopped before me. Quietly the young man asked for lodging, and my heart fell. Perhaps it was because I knew so well how it is to be tired and heavy with child. But perhaps I sensed something from the young couple that drew from me a desire to comfort and serve. I don't know, but I did know that within that hot, crowded, noisy, and odorous inn, there was no room, no single corner fit for the birth of a child, any child, but especially this child. My mind raced. My own room? Impossible. It was crowded already with my own children and members of my family who had come to pay the same tax. The sheds behind? No, again, they were small and dark, overrun with mice, dirty with disuse. But there was a stable, the shelter we kept for our animals in the hills behind the inn. There would be clean, sweet straw, open areas to admit freshness and light, but most of all, peace and privacy. And so it was to a humble stable I led them, these two extraordinary young people. And having done for them what I could, I left them to rest and return to the inn. Evening came, following it, the night foretold for centuries, hoped for, prayed for, whispered of around campfires and in synagogues, during wars, under oppression, on deathbeds. For on that night, made glorious by a burning and brilliant star and the voices of the hosts of heaven itself, was born in my stable the Son of God, the Redeemer of all people, the Savior of the world, Jesus the Christ. I saw him lying still and small in a common manger. I stood by while humble shepherds, filled with the power and perception of the Holy Spirit, bore witness that it was indeed the Messiah. I stood in the shadows, gazed at the radiance of his person, the indescribable look of joy and peace and love that transfigured the face of his mother and that of Joseph, the man chosen to care for him. I saw, and I bear solemn testimony, irrefutable, unshakable, even till death, that I saw born to Mary the Virgin, the Son of the Highest, the only begotten of the Eternal Father, Jesus the Christ. The rise and fall of dynasties, the birth and dissolution of nations, all the cycles of history as to war and peace, as to prosperity or famine, the awful and discovery, the epics, the awful happenings of earthquakes and storms, the triumphs of invention and discovery, the epics of all the occurrences that make history and are chronicled throughout the world by reference to the year before or after that night, the birth of Jesus Christ. A man never lived of whom more has been said and sung, none to whom more is devoted a greater proportion of the world's literature. He is extolled by Christian, Muslim, and Jew, by skeptic and infidel, by the world's greatest poets, philosophers, diplomats, scientists, and historians. Even in the profane sinner, in the foul sacrilege of his oath, acclaims the divine supremacy of him whose name he desecrates. saw born that night in the city of David, the one who was and is and always will be for eternity and ever, the Son of the living God, the Redeemer and the Savior of the human race, the eternal judge of the souls of all people, the chosen and appointed of the eternal Father, in short, the Christ. It is my solemn witness.
Yes, I am Mary. And yes, Jesus is my son. Indeed, blessed am I among women. My story is an old one, told and retold from before time began, and once again here today by these women, whom I love so well. It is a story of spirit, and its simple and inspiring truth must and will be manifest by the Holy Spirit rather than by spoken words. I am a woman, much as you are, and I was gifted with the divine opportunity of forming a partnership with God in providing a mortal temple for the spirit of his child. It is a sacred thing to me, this gift of motherhood to God's only begotten. The love I feel for my son is sacred, holy, and beautiful beyond description. In the pure and undefiled love I have as a mother for my child, I feel I have become closer to approaching the love of God than in any other time in my life. I testify to you that though he is my son, he is also my God. He is Jesus Christ, the Son of the Most High, the Redeemer and Savior of the world. He is the Messiah who was promised.
love and hope, peace and joy. We give you thanks for this opportunity to gather in the spirit of worship and wonder. We give thanks for mothers, especially the special mothers of the men and women we have heard about today. Thank you for their strength, their love, and their courage, and most importantly, their faith. Bless each one of us as we journey through this season of Advent, waiting with wonder and love for the celebration of the birth of Jesus, mercy and love. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All for coming this afternoon, and let us enjoy the season of Advent as we await the coming of the Christ child.